From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
On behalf of the entire staff, I want to welcome you to the second concert this month in our homegrown concert series. Today's concert is a very special occasion, and we're proud to be able to present a tradition that not many people are able to hear. It's a tradition in our own backyard from the Chesapeake Bay country of Maryland and Delaware. And so we're delighted to bring you this tradition of praise songs. I also want to say that the Homegrown Concert Series, for those of you who have not been able to come to one of our concerts before, is an opportunity for us to feature the very best of traditional music and dance from all over the country. We work collaboratively with a couple of partners in doing this, and I want to acknowledge them. We work collaboratively with the Kennedy Center at Millennium Stage to bring you these concerts, and I should add that the group here today will be performing there this evening at 6 p.m., so please go over and listen to that concert. I also want to thank the National Council for the Traditional Arts for their special assistance and support with this particular concert. I also just want to take a moment to say that we will be recording this concert for our collections. This is an opportunity for us to add to the collections of the American Folklife Center. It will eventually be put up on the web, on a webcast, so future generations can listen, enjoy, and learn. But in doing this, I just want to remind you that if you haven't turned off your cell phone, please do so now. Unless you want to be on that webcast. And lastly, when we put on these concerts, we work with a wonderful network of dedicated and talented folklorists all over the country to make this possible. They work with us to select the artists, to give us advice, and to help us. And so in this particular concert, we worked with a couple of folklorists. We worked with Cliff Murphy from the Maryland State Arts Council, and I want to thank him. I think he is out there in the audience somewhere. And we worked with Jonathan David, who is an independent folklorist and editor living in Philadelphia. And in this case, John is the obvious choice to present the singing and praying band to you today and tell you a little bit more about them, because he's the man who literally wrote the book about the tradition, which is called Together Let Us Sweetly Live, and which was published by University of Illinois Press. He's been working with the singing and praying bands for many years, and he has also produced a recording. So without further ado, I want to turn it over to him and let him tell you a little bit more about what you're going to hear. So please welcome him. Thanks.
Thank you. Let me put on my glasses so I can actually read this thing. It is my privilege to introduce the singing and praying bands of Delaware and Maryland to the audience today, as it has indeed been my privilege to work with them since fellow folklorist Polly Stewart took a really big chance and hired me to work to do survey research on the Delmarva Peninsula in 1983. And this is the continuing fruit of the Delmarva Folklife Project. The singing and praying bands continue what academics know of as a ring shout, an African-derived performance style that was thought by most to have died out. But here they are in our midst today with members who until recently worked right across the street in the U.S. Capitol building. These bands were first mentioned by name in writing by AME Bishop Daniel Alexander Payne, who mentioned that around 1850, he tried to stamp them out in his church in Baltimore. Oral history from a nearby camp meeting or a nearby church in Pasadena, Maryland, Mount Zion United Methodist, has them thriving at the beginning of their camp meeting tradition in the 1850s. Other reports don't mention them by name, but mention practices similar to today's bands, as long ago as 1817. The tradition began in secret outdoor meetings of enslaved Africans. Later, groups of worshipers also met in private homes, and still later, they found a place for themselves in Methodist prayer meetings on Sunday evenings and weekday evenings. The prayer meeting service would begin with a lined out hymn, the band say a give out hymn, and then move to a prayer, and then they end with what they call a straight hymn, or a refrain repeated over and over with two line couplets added in between each repetition of the refrain. Outsiders might know these refrains as spirituals. The band, at the end of their service, would often march around the sanctuary and then come to the fore and form a circle, and sing in a circular formation with one leader after another individually coming into the center of the ring to lead for a short time, and then going back to the exterior, and someone else would lead. Prayer meeting groups from numerous individual churches met and performed at large regional camp meetings in the Delmarva area, or in the Chesapeake and Delaware area. These Methodist camp meetings became showcases then of an African-derived style of invoking the spirit. I should say that the ring shout was in general considered one of the very African-focused service. At the height of the tradition, perhaps 100 churches had their own band, and there were thousands of tradition bearers. Today, only enough members remain from all the churches to comprise one band. The band you see today, my friends, is it. The entire tradition as it survives. Today you will notice several things. First, this line of chairs functions as what the bands would call a mourner's bench. A mourner's bench, that is, in the front of a sanctuary, you would have a bench where people seeking to be saved would kneel and have people sing or pray over them to have a conversion experience. The bands line up around this mourner's bench with a line of men behind the bench and a line of women facing the men. So what you see at the beginning will be a little odd, and that is all the sisters of the band singing with their backs to the audience, which is somewhat unusual way of performing. In the days past, when men and women sat on separate sides of a church sanctuary, and then when they got up to sing, the men would sing on one side, the women sing on the other side facing the men. Second, what you'll notice is that the band starts singing very slowly in a low pitch, and the singing escalates and it builds. There may be some off notes. The aesthetic presence does not come from band members being professional musicians who can be on from the first note. Instead, the affecting presence comes through with the band aesthetic of call and response, which the band members simply call help. We help each other. Now, what that means in a performance is that when a leader calls out a line, the others would not think of letting that leader just hang out there without a response. So they chime in with all their energy, and then the give and take of the helping each other in turn leads to an escalation of the singing. The pitch gets higher, the tempo gets faster, singing to help becomes meaningful as all the members become united in what becomes the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. And when that fellowship of the Holy Spirit is felt, often a shout breaks out and it is palpable. The audience today will be able to feel it. Everyone in the group comes on one accord and partakes in this form of communion. This is the meaning of the singing and praying in the band service, to invoke the Spirit, and then to bring others within hearing who are in the presence into the fold. Members of the audience today, I want to make sure people know this, are welcomed to stand and clap, to sing, to move, and to even cry with the singing. As the bands work the Spirit, some of you will not be able to help but feel the Spirit. This service is a spiritual method, as surely as yoga is a method or mindfulness meditation is a method. And this method, however, is one that invokes fellowship among hearers and causes an irresistible sense of communion. Individuals in the audience are welcome to join in, but keep in mind that it is a religious experience and not necessarily the musical aesthetic that is important. Thank you very much and enjoy.
Such a welcome. Thank you. Good afternoon. I'm Reverend Jerry Kolber, pastor of John Wesley United Methodist Church in Annapolis, and also the coordinator of this prayer group. And today we will actually do as we would do during a regular church service, as Jonathan said. Usually performers don't turn their back to you, but we actually not performers, we are evangelists, amen? So today we just ask you to clap your hands and pat your feet, and we come from all over, from Frankfort, Delaware, the Lower Dorchester County, and Arundel, Baltimore City, and we come together to give a ring shout out to God. And today, our first selection will be led by Frankfort AME Church, and they're gonna do In That City, and then some of our friends from Berlin gonna lead us into another hymn, Jesus Fed Me When I Was Hungry. And then we're gonna move to the Western Shore to Pasadena, Maryland, to Halls, and they will lead us in a version of Father, I Stretch My Hands to Thee. So we just say thank you for coming, and thank you.
I'm not let me die.
Yeah.
Oh, speak when I am
ready. Yeah.
Reverend Jerry Kogut.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.